Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord, guys. I hope you guys have a wonderful Monday. It has been a busy day for me, but I have to get on here. It's about almost 7 o'clock here in the afternoon, in the evening here in Colorado. But I had to come do a video because I wanted to do it yesterday. I didn't have time, but we're gonna be just talking about some things going on. I know you guys been watching the news, and a lot of things are going on in Jordan. We had three American soldiers die, and a lot of things are happening. So I'm going to come here and do a report on some updates. Lewis in Florida, BP Earthwatch, and going to get into prophecy messages today, coming from Betty S. and Stan Prophecy. He's going to be talking about the Antichrist. So we're going to get into some of these reports today on the video. And also, I'll be showing you some a testimony coming from Kenya, one of my missionaries. A testimony. I really want to just emphasize on that, guys. Having faith in Yeshua. It's not about us. It's not about us in any way. But He said to work out our salvation with fear and trembling. So you don't expect your mom or your dad or me, or pastor or preacher or anybody. To focus on your salvation. You need to be working out your own salvation with fear and trembling and trust in Yeshua Messiah. I tell you, I'm going to be just getting into the Bible today. We're going to go to Nahum, third chapter, and then so on. We'll be talking about that a little bit, but we need to know the times we're living in, and this is not the time to faint. This is not the time to sink. This is not the time to walk away. This is not the time to push the boat aside, or push Yeshua aside. And every time little things start happening, you just get fearful. It's no time for those things at all. It's time to read your Bible. It's time to get closer to the Lord. It's time to ask Him to examine your heart, examine you, and all these things we need to be doing right now in the end times. Today we're gonna get going on. We're gonna get the Maranatha. Is talk about another Pentecost is coming. So we know we got a lot of things about to happen. A lot of things are happening. And so I hope you look on the screen now. And before we get into a song, I'm gonna get into one of Paul Weber favorite songs of mine. We're gonna do one of his songs today again. And so we need to understand it's just so many things. Are going on, but the world is in God's hands. He got everything in His hand. Like the little children sing the song, He's got the whole world in His hands, So really, He has the whole world. He knows what's going on. It's nothing getting hidden from God. Okay, nothing. Okay, so He knows what's happening. So it's time to really reach out to Him and make Him your Savior today. Buy my ebook titled "He Did What" from Amazon.com. Apple, Google, Kobo.com, Lulu.com, Barnes and Noble. The link is on the screen. If you want the hardback, you can write me at marner.campbell@gmail.com and ask for a copy. I would love to have a donation if you can give a donation to help with missions. Anything you can afford to put on your heart, God put on your heart. But we usually ask for $15, but whatever God put on your heart. And also, you can just go to the ISBN number here. And also, it should be listed for $2.99. If you go to Google Play Store, make sure the quotation marks are around "He Did What." Download all my ebooks from our ebooks or my ebooks from fmcmi.org. Print edition is here. I just showed you. Click subscribe, the like bell. Subscribe to our YouTube channel. Click the like button. Click the notification bell. Fair use notices on the screen. Also, Title 17 and disclaimer. And also the FBI notice. So I'm gonna go ahead and get started now at a song here coming from the brother I like so much, if I could find him. Well, we get started here, Song of Ezekiel. So we're gonna go ahead and do that now, and we'll get started with Israel report today from Israel and other news. And guys, I'm telling you, it's just so much news, we can't hardly keep up with the news. But enjoy this song. I love this song so much. Song of Ezekiel, Your Great Name. Coming from the album Your Great Name, 2013. So let's go ahead and get started with it right now. I'm going to mute out again.
heart of man can these dry bones live? Prophesying to these dry bones, live again, live again. Those who are sleeping, those in the grave, live again, live again. Those who are sleeping, those in the grave, live again.
Raise up an arm, raise up an arm, raise up an arm. again to these dry bones. Breath of God from the four winds blow. Breathe life again to these dry bones. Breath of God from the four winds blow. Breathe life again to these dry bones. Breath of God from the four winds blow. Breathe life again.
TV7 Israel News is made possible thanks to your generous donations. Shalom, good evening. This is TV7 Israel News broadcast to you from Jerusalem and in today's top stories. Israel pledges to fight on to ensure that the atrocities committed on October 7th will never reoccur. The United States, Britain, the Netherlands, Italy, Germany, Australia, Switzerland, and Finland, among others, suspend their funding to UNRWA over its employees' involvement in the October 7th massacre in southern Israel. An Iraqi-Iranian proxy claims responsibility for killing three American service members and wounding at least 35 others in an attack on a U.S. base in Jordan. Israel continues to unyieldingly fight against terror elements in the Hamas-plagued Gaza Strip, while regional Iran-instigated tensions are evidently escalating. Earlier today, at the entrance to Rambam Hospital in the northern Israeli city of Haifa, an IDF soldier sustained severe injuries when an Islamist terrorist deliberately rammed his vehicle into the soldier before disembarking from his car and rushing toward another group of IDF troops, wielding an axe before getting himself eliminated by forces at the scene.
A short while ago, there was an incident of a terrorist attack at the entrance to Rambam Hospital gates, definitely unusual. Within a few minutes, a severely wounded young man arrived here. At the moment, he is still being treated in our ER, in the trauma room, seemingly having injuries in all limbs. Currently, he is anesthetized and ventilated and will undergo a series of operations moving forward. The hospital entrance was blocked with vehicles at this stage, and we are currently clearing that away. Now only rescue vehicles are coming in, but one can still reach the hospital on foot after a security check. The hospital will soon resume its normal activities.
Meanwhile, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu stressed that Jerusalem has no alternative to achieving the war objectives, which it clearly articulated since the IDF's ground maneuver was launched into the Gaza Strip.
Our crushing victory is more important than anything. Continue at full force so that our victory will be even more crushing. These were the final words written by heroic fighter Elkanah Wiesel, may his memory be blessed. Elkanah, a reservist, was the father of four children. He fell heroically this week in the battles in Gaza, defending our country. In this difficult week in which we lost heroic fighters, I reiterate before you, citizens of Israel, our commitment to fully implementing their testament and achieving all goals of the war, eliminating Hamas, returning all of our hostages, and ensuring that Gaza never again constitutes a threat to Israel.
The Israeli premier went on to reemphasize that Israel will never forget the atrocities committed against its people on October 7th.
We will never forget the atrocities of October 7th. We will never forget the massacre, the rapes, the murders, and the mutilations. We will never forget the abductions. As of today, We have returned 110 of our hostages, and we are committed to returning all of them home. We are dealing with this, and we are doing so around the clock, including now. We will never forgive what the Hamas monsters did to our daughters and our sons. Therefore, there is no alternative to total victory. We must win, and we will win.
At a time when Israel faces allegations of genocide, which were brought forward by the South African government, Premier Netanyahu underscored the absurdity as the Jewish state faces Islamist terrorists who sought to emulate the atrocities committed by the Nazis during World War II.
I hold here Hitler's book Mein Kampf in Arabic. Our fighters found this book in civilians' homes in the Gaza Strip. They found extensive anti-Semitic and Nazi literature there. This is what they educate their children on. Therefore, I insist that after we eliminate Hamas, what is labeled as the day after, in Gaza there will be no element that educates its children, not only for terrorism, but also for the destruction of Israel, for the destruction of the entire Jewish people. It was on behalf of the new Nazis that South Africa came to The Hague. I must tell you, the sheer willingness in The Hague to discuss this ridiculous claim, the very fact that it was not rejected outright, proves that many in the world have not learned anything from the Holocaust. But we have learned from it. The main lesson of the Holocaust is that only we will defend ourselves by ourselves. Nobody will do this for us. Therefore, despite the great pain that is burning our hearts, we must continue to be strong and determined, and we must return fire against those who seek our destruction.
The Israeli leader continued by reaffirming Jerusalem's position that its war against Hamas is a just military campaign that aims to prevent yet another massacre.
We are fighting a war, the justice of which is unparalleled, with an army, the morality of which is unparalleled. This war was forced on us by an abhorrent enemy that openly declares its intention to murder all the Jews. On October 7th, they murdered, beheaded, raped, and burned infants. If they could have, they would have massacred all of us. If we do not eliminate the Hamas terrorists, these new Nazis, the next massacre is only a matter of time.
While IDF forces continue to push ahead in the field, Prime Minister Netanyahu unveiled Jerusalem's intentions to ratchet up Israel's defense industry, which will aim to diminish foreign pressures from limiting Israel's freedom of operations.
This week, our fighters completed the encirclement of Khan Yunis. They also eliminated hundreds of terrorists and destroyed terrorist infrastructure above and below ground. They are fighting with utmost bravery to ensure our lives and our land. In order to ensure our future for generations, I have directed the defense minister and the finance minister to submit to the government an unprecedented plan, a huge plan, to strengthen our security industries for decades ahead. We will do so with immense investments in order to ensure our security, independence, and freedom of action.
Meanwhile, the United Nations has voiced outrage after its Relief and Works Agency for Palestine Refugees, or UNRWA, acknowledged and terminated the employment of a number of its UN workers who actively participated in the massacre against Israelis on October 7th.
This morning, the Secretary General has been briefed by the Commissioner General of UNRWA, Philippe Lazzarini, regarding extremely serious allegations which implicate several UNRWA staff members in the terror attacks of October 7th in Israel. The Secretary General is horrified by this news and asked Mr. Lazzarini to investigate this matter swiftly and to ensure that any UNRWA employee shown to have participated or abetted in what transpired on October 7th or in any other criminal activity be terminated immediately and referred for potential criminal prosecution.
Following the unveiling of the UN agency's involvement in the October 7th massacre, including allegedly kidnapping and subsequently hiding Israeli hostages in Gaza, Finland, Switzerland, the Netherlands, Italy, Germany, Canada, Australia, the United Kingdom, and the United States have all announced their respective decisions to terminate any pledged donations to the UN organization.
Yeah, we have suspended any outlying or yet to be allocated funds for UNRWA, the UN Relief and Works Agency, pending the results of this investigation. We're obviously going to watch this very closely. We welcome the UN Secretary General and the Commissioner General of UNRWA, their comments today calling for a full investigation. As Secretary Blinken made clear in his call with the Secretary General yesterday, we expect that that will be a complete and thorough and transparent investigation. We all want to see that. It's good for everybody. And that those who should be properly held accountable for that. And as you saw, the UN said even including the potential for a criminal prosecution.
In response to the decision to withhold pledged donations to UNRWA, a move that is expected to gain traction by additional Western-oriented nations, the Western-backed Palestinian Authority voiced its outrage, insisting that funding suspension for organizations whose employees actively engaged in terrorism constitutes a double standard and will only instigate regional war. Moreover, spokesman for Palestinian Authority Chairman Mahmoud Abbas insisted that only a few countries will follow the U.S. decision to withhold funds pending an investigation.
This step, simultaneously taken during the war in Gaza, sends a wrong message. There is a war against the Palestinian people. This decision is incorrect and should be stopped immediately. We urge all these countries to repay the UNRWA because it's a humanitarian issue. Nobody will follow what America is saying. There are three, four countries follow America everywhere, in the Security Council or in the ICJ or whatever. We hope that this policy would end. They tried it hundreds of times. They failed. They should understand very well that they have to change their policies in case they wanted peace and security in the Middle East. You have seen what's going on here in Palestine, in Lebanon, in Syria, in Yemen, in Iraq, and everywhere. It's a regional or almost a regional war in the whole area, and they should understand very well that the starting point of ending this war is establishing a Palestinian state. The refugee problem is very important. The satisfaction of the Palestinian people is very important, and this is the starting point. Otherwise, continuous wars in the region, and everybody will pay a heavy price.
Meanwhile, in the Gulf of Aden, the Iranian proxy Ansar Allah in Yemen claimed responsibility for yet another missile attack against a commercial vessel.
In response to the American-British aggression against our country, Yemeni naval forces carried out a targeting operation on the British oil tanker Marlin Luanda in the Gulf of Aden using a number of appropriate naval missiles. The strike was direct and resulted in the burning of the vessel.
The Houthi attack sparked a blaze on board the commercial vessel, which after an Indian warship intervened, it was successfully subdued.
So I really thank the Indian warship INS Vishakhapatnam. They have done a really tremendous job. We had actually lost the hope that we won't be able to fight this fire, but these guys were really tough.
U.S. Secretary of the Navy Carlos Del Toro, during an interview, was asked to provide an assessment as to how long we should expect the blatant Houthi attacks against maritime shipping to persist.
Well, to your first question, I think perhaps we should ask around that question, right? They continue to support Houthis financially and with weapons capabilities as well, too. As discovered by the Dow that we were able to interdict in the Red Sea, where we lost two Special Forces Navy SEALs. So perhaps we should ask them for how long this will continue. My hope and expectation is that it will not continue indefinitely, and that we'll be able to go back to peacetime operations in the Red Sea and allow all this shipping to proceed peacefully. This isn't just about a military solution, it's about a diplomatic solution, right? And they're all interrelated in one way or another. So we have a moral responsibility to protect those innocent merchant mariners from countries from around the globe who sail these ships for the economic benefit of all nations. We have a moral responsibility to protect our own sailors, both in the United Kingdom and the United States and all the other allies that are partnered with us as well, too. But it's obvious that it will take more than just a military solution to this problem in order to resolve the issues in the Middle East, with impact, obviously, on what's going on in the Red Sea.
While the Biden administration continues to make every effort to secure a diplomatic solution, as part of its policy of containment, the Iranian proxy in Iraq have claimed responsibility for a drone strike that targeted a U.S. base in the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan, killing 3 American service members and wounding at least over 35 others.
I want to point out that we had a tough day last night in the Middle East. We lost 3 brave souls. Attack on one of our bases.
Yes.
And I'd ask you for a moment of silence for all 3 of those fallen soldiers.
Jeez.
And we shall respond.
Fearing looming retribution, Iran's foreign ministry sought to distance itself from the deadly attack despite its evident role.
Resistance groups in the region do not take orders from the Islamic Republic of Iran in their decisions and actions. While the Islamic Republic of Iran does not welcome the development of conflict in the region, it does not interfere in the decisions of the resistance groups on how to support the Palestinian nation or defend themselves and their people against any aggression and occupation. Repeating baseless accusations that say Iran had a role in this attack. Against Iran is the projection and conspiracy of those who see their interests in dragging America's feet into a new battle in the region and inciting it in the expansion and escalation of the crisis to cover up their problems. Iran monitors developments in the region with readiness and vigilance, and the responsibility for the consequences of accusations of incitement against Iran lies with the perpetrators of such baseless accusations.
Thank you for watching TV7 Israel News. I'd like to encourage you, pray for the peace of Jerusalem and salvation of Israel. Moreover, it is important to highlight that TV7 Israel is a donation-based nonprofit ministry with all of our productions available free of charge. Therefore, if you're blessed by our daily updates and would like to help us bear the costs, please consider making a donation. You can do so by visiting our website, www.tv7israelnews.com. I'm Jonathan Hessen, wishing you a Shavuot Tov Mevorach, and God willing, we'll see you during our upcoming TV7 Israel updates. Until then, Shalom from Jerusalem.
And God bless every single one of you. Today is January 29, 2024, and welcome to the Grand Supreme News Channel. All right, guys, so we have some urgent information coming out. If you can, please share this video. And it says here, put nuclear in Cuba. This is coming out from the Bear MP. Alexei has suggested that the Bear capital should deploy missiles in friendly countries. You guys already know, back in the 60s, yeah, that was pretty big. A lot of people were holding signs saying the end of the world has come. So you had Cuba pointing their missile towards the sleeping giant, the bear pointing missile towards the sleeping giant, and the sleeping giant were pointing missiles at them. All right, we're about to see a repeat of history on this one here, guys. Also, I just posted a video not too long ago. This link will be in the comments box. Very important information coming out. It says here, as early as tonight, the Sleeping Giant leader will authorize Sleeping Giant military action in the Mid-E. It is likely to be one of the most consequential decisions of his presidency. At stake, the credibility of Sleeping Giant deterrence and a teetering of stability of the region. All right, so they're giving the green lights for tonight. Now, we don't know if it's going to be a strike on Persia or possibly in somewhere like other country, Iraq or Syria. We don't know. All we know is that that information is coming out and they're sounding the alarm that something big is coming within hours. All right, guys, before I start getting...
The 29th, 2024. Guys, I've got an update from Fox News, and I'm going to play that short clip of that video at the end of this, but I want to say a few things first. We're looking at a political movie. The Republicans know they can gain a lot of points by exposing Biden's administration and failures along the border. Not just, I mean, there's a lot of failures in many places around the world. The Democrats are starting to also turn, and this is the real reason for the video, along with the mainstream media, against Biden also. But there's a reason for that, and that is what I would consider Obama's third four-year election. Probably go into eight, because it looks like they're going to throw Joe under the bus. Goodbye, Brandon. And they're going to put Michelle in there because technically Barack cannot do it. He's had his 8 years. But this is a big game. How it will play out, we don't know. But it looks like it's totally political. There will not be, in my opinion, looking at more and more information and listening to some very powerful people that know about this, and watching it for a couple of days, is that there's no way there will be a civil war. It's going to be a political war, and how that will turn out, we don't know. We saw what happened in 2020. I don't have to talk about it. We know things were shut down at night, and then by in the morning, a new God had arisen, and the votes had changed. Well, anyway, they think they may not can get away with those same sleight of hand tricks this time, because it's becoming more and more obvious, not to me and you, but to the majority of the U.S., what really happened. So they can play this, the Democrats can play this card that yes, Joe is a bad deal, and pull in the third Obama administration. That's what it looks like to me. On the other side of this card, we do have the convoy situation setting up. But that looks to me to be really a non-event. I've looked at their maps. They're not coming anywhere close to the border. There's not 700,000 people. There were 20 vehicles when they left Virginia this morning. And I hate to say it, I really enjoy watching a couple of YouTubers that go in and cover this. But I think it's the organizers. I saw one video where one of the YouTubers that are covering the information was talking to one of the organizers. And it reminded me of complete control. In other words, they were anticipating some type of movement to join Texas, which really is not publicly needed if you've got 25 plus states sending troopers and supplies in there. You know what I'm saying? They're prepared for the fight. But again, the trucker organization is not even coming to the border. They're going to be in, like, along the interstate north of it and things like that, and they're going to be in three places on the same day, I think February the 3rd. Don't know how effective that will be, but if you're bringing in the new CBDC digital currency, which will have complete control, it will end up like in Canada. Remember the convoy that went up, was at Ottawa? during the snow, jammed all the traffic, ended up getting a lot of people debanked, locked up, trucks confiscated, and all that. You remember that? Then you remember that the People's Convoy last year ended up, a lot of people watched it. I did. We were all hopeful that there would be some changes, but it looked like, again, by the time that was over, the organizers had pre-planned for the event of people in the U.S. that were patriots rising up, and they controlled it. What better way to do it than drive you from California to Washington and back to California, back to Washington, use up all your money, use up all your resources, and you then fizzle it all out by ripping off some of the donators. And that's what happened in the People's Convoy. And so that the difference now between last year and now is because we could be very quickly, because banks are collapsing around the world. China is collapsing. The world's leading economic system is collapsing. Bankrupt on their largest commercial real estate endeavor today, declared bankruptcy. And their real estate GDP is higher than any other form of GDP in any other nation in the world. But anyway, so now people donating to the truckers' convoy, which there was no trucks in it when it left Virginia Beach this morning, 20 cars and a couple of campers, bus maybe. All of that's being recorded. Everything, listen, I'm for those people, but you got to look at it real. And you got to realize what could happen with this digital currency situation, the complete control, is that if you donate, which I hate to say that because I'm not trying to stop any type of people protesting. That's not, but this is not a protest. They're not going to the border. But a lot of people being dragged into it are going to lose everything, in my opinion, because they're going to say, oh, you donated to so-and-so during this convoy. Now, you think, well, that maybe that sounds cowardly, but it's not, because I've seen what's happened. Don't fall for the same bread and circus tactics every time they try to pull it off. But the Republicans are looking at it, well, we can get rid of Biden. But it's an election year. Everyone, not only here, Germany, France, guys, they have real protest over there. Thousands and thousands of tractors are blocking Paris over their Green Deal, trying to eliminate the farmers. But that's going on in Germany, Paris, a couple other nations. And it's like a great movement going forward from here. But here in the U.S., guys, the military, the National Guard, Border Patrol, they have it under control. Regardless if whoever's controlling it is who's someone that we agree with or not, they have that under control. And you've got 25-plus state governors in control. So if you want to get in trouble for following an organized event, again, I hate to say it, but you got to grow up to the point you see the tricks of the trade. If you want to get involved with that, then it's on you. Because they have already said they're not going to the border. They have no trucks involved in it now at all. But everyone that donates to them, you should find a way to do it in a cash or something else, some other way. Because it's going to come back to haunt you. Everyone in the convoy is not guilty of this. Most of them are not. But the organizers, I'm afraid, are saying, okay, let's take advantage of this situation. Probably a government-controlled deal. Let's see who the patriots are that we hate. And some of the people in the convoy could be part of that problem, that they've been paid to be in place to something that will have no effect on the border, but we'll draw out patriots. Look at the website. They want patriots, mama bears, all the things that patriots talk about. They name them. This is who we want to be involved with. Guys, and it's everywhere. Why would that happen? Why is mainstream talking about what they call the convoy, the Army of God convoy on mainstream media? Why are they promoting it when they would promote nothing else? You hardly ever heard of the People's Convoy, right? I mean, a lot of us watched it, but it wasn't on mainstream media. Ted Cruz came in there, and then after he left, things went downhill really quick. But it's a big game being played. We got too many rhinos on the Republican side, and they're talking about impeaching Mayorkas. Well, the bad thing about that, and I'm going to play the update from Fox and the Border Patrol head of their union. They're saying, yes, the Republicans could bring about the impeachment of, or the attempted impeachment of Mayorkas. But once it leaves the Republican House and gets to the Democrats, it's going to be thrown out. And they know this. They know it's not going to go anywhere with Mayorkas. It's not going to happen. Maybe in the next administration you may see some repercussions, but I doubt it. Remember, we're going to lock her up. Yeah. Anyway, so it's a big game. It's a big deception. It's a political theater, and a lot of people are going to get in trouble with it. Everyone needs to stand up for their rights. And again, I'm not downing anyone in the convoy, which is a carvoy. It's not a convoy. There's no trucks in it yet. They'll be in Jacksonville tonight, a couple hours. But what I'm trying to do is warn people that are trying to be patriotic and heroic from walking into a trap. Let me play that video from Fox. It was just about an hour or so ago, guys. We're watching it. You watch it. It's a heads up. Be safe.
Let me help you with that.
I'm good, man. Thanks.
Are you sure?
Everyone can use a little help.
House Republicans stepping up their efforts to hold the administration accountable for the chaos at our southern border. A House committee releasing two articles of impeachment against Homeland Security Secretary Alejandro Mayorkas over the weekend. Speaker Mike Johnson says he intends to hold a House-wide vote as soon as possible. Let's bring in Brandon Judd, National Border Patrol Council President. Brandon, it's good to see you. Here's what Mark Green, the chairman of the House Homeland Security Committee, said about forwarding these articles of impeachment. He said, having exhausted all other options to hold Secretary Mayorkas accountable, it is unmistakably clear that Congress must exercise its constitutional duty and impeach him. Green, Johnson believe that they've got the votes to pass this in the House. They might even be able to have a trial or at least put forward the articles of impeachment.
All right, guys, you can play the rest of that video. It's not but a few more minutes. I'm going to stop because I got other videos to show. But, yeah, a lot of things have been going on in Texas, and people was wondering what's going on. I was up last night looking at a lot of material, and they was talking about 700,000 trucks coming in from Canada and all over the place. One YouTuber, and so I'm glad BP Earthwatch is kind of giving you an idea what the update really is and what's happening. Seem like it's no trucks at all. He's saying like it's cars, okay? So I don't know, guys. A lot of deceptions, a lot of things are going on. Yeshua said in the end times we'll have rumors of wars even. All kind of things are happening. So we sometimes don't know the truth from what the truth really is. So it's best to just watch and pray. Pray and watch. I'm going to go on over here now and get into something I want you guys to see. I want you guys to see this here. Real quick here, I want you guys to go watch it at your own time. I know a lot of people have been talking about all the stuff going on in Israel, and I've been hearing this for many years about the, I can't even find it now. Where did I put that at? About the the scattered sons of Jacob. So I was watching this last night, and I thought it was a pretty good documentary. About the black Hebrew, the cursed and the scattered. So if you want to watch it, you can go and watch it. Thank you so much. I think one of my subscribers sent it to me. But I do know that it's all about, you know, this stuff here can get really controversial. But I'm telling you guys, we all have to be born again. We all have to go through the seed of Yeshua, his DNA. And so I know that I dreamed about the Exodus myself. I dreamed about the big wilderness experience. All these different people was there, black, white, green, purple, Japan, China, Indians, it don't matter what nationality it was, all of them was there in the wilderness. God has all his people scattered and all his people coming together in the end times. He's going to send angels after them. He's going to get them together because it's a lot of people out in the whole wide world who love Messiah Yeshua, not just the black Hebrews, not just black people, not just white people. It's all people, going to be all nationalities of people who are going to be going home to the kingdom of God when the trumpet sound, when the rapture come, when we have, if we're going to have an exodus or a wilderness. You know, but we need to just stop all the this controversial stuff going on. But I know this is a pretty good documentary. I don't really have anything negative to say about it right now. But I know Yeshua got his tribes all over the world. And he's going to be gathering them. And we know we're going to be having a real, I don't know if the Pentecost, another Pentecost coming. I'm going to be playing that today for Maranatha. But I know God is in charge. Whatever he decide to do, when he decide to do it, you know, that's what we need to just be ready. We need to just be ready, be ready, be ready, making sure you're on the right side, okay? But I'm going to put this here for you guys to listen to if you want to listen to it. And I'm going to go on over here now and get into this other video that I did back in 4 years ago. 4 years ago, I did this video and I put the person on the screen. You can see him, who it is, Betty S., and so I will let you know to go look at that video again. War will enter. War will enter. Desperate times coming. And today I'm going to be reading this one here that I got here this week. And I'm going to share it with you right now. And then we're going to get into Stan message. Antichrist soon to arrive. And then we're going to get into the missions and the Bible. So I'm going to do it in that order. I don't think there's nothing else here I'm forgetting about. But I thank you guys for being here today. And I'm just saying, I've been feeling so elevated in the Holy Spirit lately. I'm telling you, I just want to get on a cave and go somewhere to, with my guitar and just play and sing song to the Lord and worship him. And that's all I would want to do. But I have to stay here and take care of the ministries and be a wife and all this stuff. But I'm telling you, I'm really loving my Father. He's coming soon, guys. We need to get ready. We need to get absolutely ready. Because things about to just take off really fast. And if we don't know the word, and we don't know to stand on our own tub, our own bottom, and with the Lord, not dependent on everybody else, not dependent on anybody. You should be knowing who you're going to serve, who you're going to stand for, and you need to know that you know that you know that you know. Nobody else can tell you your experience with God. Nobody can tell you your experience if you had a born-again experience, and you need to be having that born-again experience if you haven't had it, because everybody else is going to be telling you and messing your mind up and gets confusing you, and if you don't know Yeshua for yourself, if you don't know Jesus Christ for yourself as your personal Savior and have a relationship with him, it's not going to be good. It's not going to be good. And so we have to be watching ourselves. I have to watch myself because, you know, I don't want to be deceived. I don't want to have nobody coming to me telling me lies and taking my my salvation away or trying to bamboozle me, anything like that. So we need to know that you know that you know. I know a wonderful lady. I know some people don't like her. I already heard negative stuff. I don't care about the negative stuff. I care about people's testimony. I care about people knowing the Bible. I care about people knowing the Lord. And Christine Kane is a woman I found here like some weeks ago that I've really been listening to her videos a lot. So if you want to be encouraged, flourish in the Lord and learn about faith and walking with the Lord, I advise you to listen to some of her videos. I mean, really, the ones I've seen and heard so far, I really love them, okay? And I don't care what denomination she is, it don't matter to me, okay? I just know I like her messages of faith, of standing for Yeshua, standing for the Lord, knowing who you're going to serve. And, you know, and trusting him and believing in him. And that's what we all need now, is to be elevated, elevated, elevated in the Lord, knowing that he is the only one can save you, the only one can help you. I'm telling you guys, it's just amazing when you really start walking with the Lord. So let me go ahead and do this, because I want to get to my testimony here that I want to share later too from my brother over in Kenya. Don't want to forget Gautry's testimony. So let's go here now and say, it's on the screen here, and I'm hoping that nothing happens with this video, but I'm going to share it anyway. This is back in June 17. She sent it to me this week, and I told her I would share it, so I'm going to share it again. It says here, this is not a time to argue among yourselves. Absolutely. This is not a time to argue among yourselves. There is great battles going on in the heavenlies. There is also great anticipation for the coming of the bride, alas. There is also those being made ready for war. The bride's table is all set. It is adorned. It awaits its bride like a wooing bridegroom. He comes. He places the ring on your finger and says, now you are betrothed to me and no one else. While others are ready themselves for a fierce battle as they put on their war gear. Ephesians 6:11-20. I saw myself dressed for battle, having on all the attire. I stood ready. A man came up to me, fierce, but also loving, and I knew him to be Jesus. And he said, are you truly ready? You must be prepared for anything in battle. And he moved on. And I remembered him saying a long time ago, count the cost and then make your call sure. And I knew that long ago, I knew the cost. And I remember him telling me, it will cost you something, everything. Tell the people that if they choose to follow me, it will cost them. And I remember asking him about this once again. And he said, it will cost you your family, your friends, your job, your finances, your comfort, and even your life. Are you ready to follow me and not turn back? Are you ready to make that commitment? Think long and hard about this. Don't go into denial, because it applies to all those that say, I am a Christian. I am the bride. And you will have to choose this day. Many are called, but few are chosen, because it makes us accountable. And many will refuse and be in rebellion. I remember that time when he asked me, just like he is asking again. And I had doubts. But yes, I chose to follow him. It was not easy. It has not been easy, she says. It has not been easy. And there were times I wanted to go back to the way it was, but I knew I couldn't. And yes, I had to go through some of the aforementioned things and letting go. It has been a roller coaster ride, but worth it. It will not be easy, and change never is. And we can't look back, or we are not fit for the kingdom. So we move forward one step at a time, one day at a time. And if we fall, we get right back up and keep moving. Oh, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I believe you, Betty S. Absolutely. You get back up and keep moving. I've done it in my life many, many times. Don't let the devil take your crown, guys. Okay? Just get back up and keep moving. God is calling. Will you answer? If so, fasten your seatbelts, because you are going to be in for the ride of your life. Shalom. So that's coming from Betty S. And I hope you go and look at, replay this video of mine that I did back in 4 years ago. And before they take it down, I hope they don't take it down. But anyway, listen to it, guys. I'm going over here now and get into the Antichrist soon to arrive. And then we're going to get into missions and a testimony and in the Bible. So let me go ahead and do that right now. Let me go ahead and mute out again.
Welcome to the Prophecy Club. I've got some really important information for you today. It is a big sign. I'm going to say one of the biggest signs I've seen in a long time that the Antichrist is soon to arrive. A big sign, the Antichrist is soon to arrive. And in light of this, he could be arriving, I'm guessing, 24, but more like 25. And the closer we move towards 26 and 27, it's almost a certainty somewhere in there we're going to see the Antichrist. Now, let me also tell you how to spot him real quickly. That's not part of the program. I'm just doing this off the top of my head. But there, first of all, there has to be a 10-nation confederacy in Europe. Then we're going to see a guy overcome three of those nations. So that means that he will take their place. So we'll see the 10-nation confederacy, three overcome, and then what? So we'll see that 10-nation confederacy become an 8-nation confederacy. So when there's a big war in Europe where there's one of the nations that is fighting against the other nations, that's the guy to watch for. That's the guy that will probably be the Antichrist. All right, now, before we get into today's, we're asking people to subscribe and also click the bell. Subscribe and also join the Prophecy Club. $9.90 a month is not much, or more, of course. And you can do that very quickly and easily by just putting your phone up, like you're going to take a picture of the QR code in the bottom. It'll take you over there, $9.90 a month. We're asking people to join us. And frankly, you may be saying, why don't I want to join the Prophecy Club? Well, God has told me, audible voice, confirmed it through Leslie in a dream, that he's going to give me thousands upon thousands of souls. Another dream, audible voice, I'm giving you part of the harvest from the seeds sown by Billy Graham. If you want to take part in that big harvest, when you're standing before Jesus up there, you want to be able to raise your hand and say, hey, I helped all of those souls come in through Prophecy Club. Then you want to join Prophecy Club. Okay, so I want to be able to say this is quick and easy, but this is not. It takes a little understanding. The more you understand Bible prophecy, the better you're going to get it. But the bigger the revelation, and this is a big one, the bigger the background has to be to understand it. Meaning, here's what's probably going to go in this program. You're probably going to be going, so, get to the point. And then when I get to the point, you're going to say, wow, I got it. And you're going to get it. Not that complicated. All right, let's get started. I want you to look at this carefully because this is really big. What you're seeing has not happened in over 2,000 years. You're seeing three red heifers. Now, I know you probably already heard that they're shipping a bunch of them over to Israel. That's not the revelation. That's part of it, but that has to do with it. But that's not the revelation. So, what is the revelation? Here's the background. So you go to Numbers 19, and Moses and Aaron were told by God that they were to take a red heifer without spot, no blemish, upon which there would never came a yoke. In other words, so it had to be perfect. And they were to take that heifer without the camp. That's a key. Because, see, Jesus was crucified without the camp. He was taken outside the city. And when he brings the Russians and all of their other buddies down to attack Israel for Armageddon, they are taken without the camp. Because where Jesus' blood, well, where the blood of this heifer probably will be shed is probably very close, maybe even within feet, of where Jesus' blood was shed. And that's where he's going to shed the blood of all of his enemies at Armageddon. He's going to satiate his garments with their blood. So remember that the life is in the blood. And you remember that Cain slew Abel, and Abel's blood was innocent blood crying out to him from the ground. So we can assume that the blood somehow is like a recording device for all of our sins. And it's by blood, the Bible says, that without the shedding of blood, there's no remission or removing of sins. So this is really, really a big deal. Now, so they take him outside the camp, and then the priest was told to take the blood of that red heifer, dip his finger in it, and sprinkle it before the tabernacle and the congregation seven times. Same thing he was told when he said on the Day of Atonement, when they brought the two goats, the blood of the one goat went into a golden bowl. The angel or the high priest took that into the Holy of Holies only once a day, or excuse me, once a year, and dipped his finger into it and sprinkled it on the mercy seat eastward seven times. So this is really, really big stuff. Now, he goes on to say, one person shall burn the heifer. And then he says, and then cedar wood, hyssop, and scarlet is tossed in on top of the burning heifer when it's burning. So I looked up, okay, cedar wood. Okay, we understand. Cedar wood, I mean, you put that in a closet because moths don't like it. Okay, so it's an anti-bug thing. And then hyssop, we understand. It's a weed that grows wild in Israel. And you, if you mix yourself a hyssop drink, it cleans like a white tornado. You think X-Lice is powerful, you ain't tried anything till you tried hyssop. I mean, I got some hyssop essential oil. I didn't know what it was. Well, I tried it. So I just put a drop on the back of my hand. About an hour later, I'm in the bathroom. So, I mean, it's real powerful stuff. So I looked up scarlet. So I thought, okay, so what's the big deal with scarlet? Well, actually, scarlet is talked about like 200 some odd times in the Bible. It's really big. Now, here's the point. Okay, so in this case, the first child came out, and so they wrapped a scarlet twine on the hand of the child that came out first. So scarlet in that case said that you are more blessed by having the scarlet. And then another place, it said that the high priest was to put scarlet along with the sacrifice of the two birds, alive and clean. So scarlet there was a cleanser. And then another place, the scarlet shall, I told you that story, or the another scripture says, Isaiah 1:18, though your sins be as scarlet, they should be white as snow. So scarlet is, and I looked it up, and I looked up scarlet wood, I looked up scarlet plant, I looked up scarlet spices. I couldn't find anything about scarlet. So it's out there. I just couldn't find anything on the internet about it, and I'm probably going to get some emails. Okay, this is what scarlet meant. Okay, it's probably a purifier, just like the other two things are. And that's the point I'm trying to make. Now, let's go on with what the scripture says. Okay, so a man that is clean shall gather the ashes of the heifer and lay them without the camp in a clean place. What they did was they made a vessel that they called a kalial. Now, might not be pronouncing that right, and I'm going to have it written down here, and I'm probably not spelling it right, so forgive me. But that kalial was made of the dung of the animal, and they put the ashes of the red heifer into it. And then, when they had to sacrifice, what they did is they took a straw, and they dipped it in those ashes, and then they sprinkled it upon the vats of purification. Remember, Jesus turned the water into wine, the vats of purification. They're large vats. So a little bit of this ashes goes a long way. Then what they would do is take their hyssop again, remember, a wild weed that grows in Israel, and they dip the hyssop in the water, and they sprinkle that on the Sanhedrin, on the sacrifice, on the altar, on the temple, everything that has to be pure. But without the ashes of a red heifer, they can't have things purified, so they can't start animal sacrifice. Now, let's go on. It says that an unclean person shall then take the ashes of the burnt heifer on purification sin and dip it in running water. That's what it's saying. A clean person should take the hyssop, dip it in there, and sprinkle it on the tenth, the vessel, dot out all those things I said. And the clean person shall sprinkle on the unclean, and that makes them, essentially, that's what it's saying. It cleans them. Now, part of the motivation for Israel to give the Palestinians a state is probably in the agreement that says they'll give the Palestinians a state. What Israel wants is access to the temple. To the Temple Mount. Why? Because they're going to start animal sacrifice. Well, how do we know they're going to start animal sacrifice? I'm so glad you asked. So let's jump to Daniel. We got four verses that say exactly that. Yea, he magnified himself, this is the Antichrist, even to the price of a prince of the host, so he says he is God. That's, Antichrist does not mean against Christ, it means in the place of Christ. That's what he wants to be. Remember, Lucifer wanted to sit in the throne of God, and he wants people to... So he sat in the throne of God, showing himself that he is God. That's what he wants. That is his crowning achievement, is to sit on the throne of God and get the world to worship him. That's where all of this is going. So when they say, well, I don't understand why Haley is not dropping out of the New Hampshire primary. I don't understand. They don't understand where it's really going because they don't understand Bible prophecy. They're saying, oh, well, you know, they're trying to cause... No, no. The ultimate objective is to bring the Antichrist so he can sit on the golden chair of God, the throne of God, in the temple, proclaiming himself that he is God. And when he does that, the scripture says he will cause animal sacrifice to cease. Now, why would he cause animal sacrifice to cease? Because he's going to say, look, I am God. You don't have to sacrifice anymore. I'm here, okay? So, in the midst of the week, he shall cause the sacrifice and the oblation to cease. What's the problem with that? Well, they aren't sacrificing animals in Israel anymore, and they have not done that for over 2,000 years. So this is really, really, really big. And the problem is this red heifer, these red heifers have not been, every time there's something wrong with them. There's a white hair they find, or there's a scratch on them or something. They have been trying to get a red heifer for, again, over 2,000 years. And of course, they've been back in the land for what is an almost 80 years. I can't get a red heifer. So bottom line is a bunch of Texas ranchers that had red cows flew five of them over to Israel. Now, this next article is about to say that's the real reason that Hamas attacked Israel, because they were afraid they were going to get these five heifers. If they get the five heifers, then they start animal sacrifice. If they are able to start the animal sacrifice, that means they're going to take over the temple area, and the Muslims have that right now. That also would mean that they're, at least their belief now, I disagree with it, but that's nevertheless their belief, they would then say, well, we got to tear down the Al-Aqsa Mosque, which is, I think, the number three holy site in Islam, might be number two. Anyway, let's read the article. Hamas spokesman blames Israel's importing of red heifers for October attack. It says the real motives, they're saying. For the October massacre, he said that the aggression was against our path and Al-Aqsa reached its peaks with the bringing of the red cows. See, everybody's been thinking, well, they probably did this attack because they want a Palestinian state. I have not heard that one time. Now, you'd think it's out there a bunch, but I have not heard that in all the articles that you guys send me, all of my everything. I've not heard that. In other words, there's no Muslim saying we attacked Israel because we want a Palestinian state. This is the only explanation that I've heard offered. Got another one? Send it to me. Anyway, it goes, the bringing of red cows, which was referring to the 2022 arrival of five red heifers to the Temple Institute. Temple Institute. Well, that might just be the place, but maybe it's not the place, where Jesus was born, where it is where the temple sacrifice animals, the lambs and the goats and the whatever it is, are raised in a special way so that they're not damaged, they're not blemished, so they can be used for sacrifice. Anyway, let's go back. 22 arrival of the five red heifers to the Temple Institute. The Jewish organization focused on establishing the third temple on the Temple Mount in Jerusalem. Well, I think that they've got the wrong place for the Temple Mount, and I don't think they're going to be building a stone building. I think that they will pull out the original tabernacle that was made of lamb's wool. And I talked to Vindel Jones back before he died, I don't know, 30, 35 years, maybe even 40 years ago. He said that when he went into the chamber where he found the red dust, which they felt like was temple incense, he said in that temple, he also found the tabernacle of Moses. And I said, well, wouldn't that be old and dilapidated, just fall apart in your hands like ash? He said, no, it's as good as the day as it was the day is sent in there because it's made of lamb's wool. And he said, it's good. He believed that they would pull out the original tabernacle made and used by Moses some 3,500 years ago. And in those days, they would just lay it down on the ground. The Spirit of God entered into it, and it just stood up by the power of God. Those kind of miracles we may be about to see. Now, there's a couple more things I need to say about this. Where these heifers are supposed to be born is in the specific area in Bethlehem where the animals for temple sacrifice are to be born. And like the lambs, they wrap them in swaddling clothes so it would restrict them so they would not scratch themselves or put a blemish on them. And that's why Jesus was wrapped in swaddling clothes, because he was born in the specific place where animals to be used for temple sacrifice are born. That's why he was wrapped in swaddling clothes. So, because fingernails on newborns are like razors, and you know, they scratch their face all the time. If there's one scratch, it disqualifies them to be a sacrifice. But really, really big deal, okay? And that's why Jesus was wrapped in swaddling clothes. That's why the Bible went to the trouble to tell us he was. Now let's go on. Well, it goes on to say the heifers are quietly being groomed by the Institute for their ultimate goal, which is to start animal sacrifice. So what you're seeing here is like really, really big. They have not sacrificed these animals yet, probably because they don't have a place to use their blood. But to me, I think this is another really, really, really big thing saying. We're about to see the conclusion of this war with Hamas in Israel. Is probably going to give the Palestinians a state. And in that agreement, Israel will be able to pray at the Temple Mount, and they've not been able to do that in over 2,000 years. It will allow them to sacrifice the animal, use the ashes to purify the water, the hyssop, the weeds, sprinkle all the things that must be cleansed, and boom, they start animal sacrifice. That will be a big day in Israel. When you see that, one thing you can say is absolutely, positively, without question, we are in the tribulation. We are in the last 7 years, no question. Actually, I'm going to show you scripture here. Well, I think I'm back. I'll skip that for now. Let's go on. Back to the article. Securing a potential unblemished red heifer is the key to the first steps of restarting the temple service or sacrifice, which implies the removal of the Al-Aqsa Mosque and the Omar building. Rebuilding the temple and ultimately the return of the Temple Mount to Jewish control, meaning starting animal sacrifice. The mere fact that all Jews would be able to ascend to Temple Mount would create pressure to resume services there and rebuild the temple. No, be the reason they did, okay? The current effort to rebuild the temple is not supported by Israel's government or universally supported within Judaism, but the step toward performing the arcane red heifer ceremony doesn't just imply a return to the Holy Temple service. It points to the nearness of Moshiach, or Messiah, or the Mashiach, however you want to pronounce that, and the ultimate redemption of Israel. In other words, when they start animal sacrifice, this voice is going to be saying, without a question, we are in the tribulation, and we may, in fact, only have 120 to most 230 days, but probably more like 120 days until Jesus returns. So let's go on though. So let me summarize this. The red heifer is taken outside the camp and sacrificed. It is a picture of Jesus being taken outside the camp and sacrificed on the cross. The ashes were then put into a kallel, which was made of the dung of the animal. Then they dipped a straw in, and whatever ashes, small amount of ashes, stuck to the straw, then they sprinkled that over the vats of purification water. And that purified them. Then they took hyssop, dipped it in, and they sprinkled that on the Sanhedrin, the altar, the sacrifice, whatever they needed to purify in order to start animal sacrifice. Then the red heifer has not been seen. They've been trying to find one, been trying to grow one, couldn't, for over 2,000 years. Now, all of a sudden, when the Palestinians are about to be given a state, when there's just been war in Israel, now about there, they've got red heifers in Israel ready to sacrifice. I don't know if that's all approved yet or not, but they know. So It is supposed to be born in Bethlehem, where animals are raised and temple sacrifice. Apparently, that does not matter to the priest in Israel. Maybe they don't even know the place 2,000 years later. But the point is, if they sacrifice an animal, if they start animal sacrifice, we're at the door. And there is no more question. Absolutely there. And I will be screaming from the top of my voice. We are in the tribulation. We are, okay? Let me go on. So I want you to try to get this picture. Try to get this revelation. So Israel gives the Palestinians a state. Haven't seen a war in Israel since 1967. Now all of a sudden we see one in 2023. And it's still going on in 24. As part of the agreement, you watch. I bet you Israel takes control of the Temple Mount. That'll be part of the agreement. This allows Jews to pray at the temple, which has not been done over 2,000 years. It allows the Jews to sacrifice a red heifer, clean themselves, and start animal sacrifice. Then, and only then, the Antichrist steps forward and stops the animal sacrifices on or near the middle of the tribulation. 2 Thessalonians 2:4 says he sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. That's the goal of Lucifer. He wants to be God. He wants the worship he saw God get. And this happens on about or around in the middle of the tribulation. So the Antichrist, the arrival of the Antichrist, in my opinion, must be soon. Now, let me put this together in a picture here.
It sounds exciting times are before us, guys. Time is running here, so I got to hop on over here to a picture I want to show you guys of testimony of my wonderful missionary over in Kenya, Gayatri. I'm going to show you something here quick, and then I'm going to get into missions and the Bible real quick. But I'm telling you, we are in the end, at the end. All the things that Daniel and all these guys are talking about for many centuries are right in our face. Everything's about to be happening. The earth will be filled with an awareness of the glory of the Lord. We know that people need to just get ready because it's wartime. Everything can happen. Anything can happen. I love this here. One day you will wake up and there will be no more to do the things you have always dreamed of. Do them now. We need to just work while it is day, because we are in the time of war and all kind of things are going on around us. So these are the pictures here. I'm going to show you the pictures here. I'm going to tell you a little testimony about it right now. I'm going to read it from what he sent me. Gayatri. I show you guys Gayatri all the time on my channel. He's one of the missionaries there. And so what he said to me... he said, let me see if I can find what he said here. Oh, boy. He said, praise God, Sister Marner. Praise God. I pray you are doing well. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Yah is so wonderful. It is good. A hardware dealer. Listen to this, guys. A hardware dealer. I can't pronounce his name here, so I'm just going to say the hardware dealer. Mr. O, because I can't pronounce his last name, has agreed to give us iron sheets on credit. We shall be paying her and her husband little by little until the time we finish. They are good people, born again people. They love Yah. Probably they may join us for Sabbath worship services coming up. Continue praying for them. So this is what happened, because, you know, he's been putting up this church. He told me that some months ago that the people, 400 people he had been giving Bibles to and talking to, and they all coming to the conclusion that the Sabbath is a sign for God's people, that the Sabbath, the seventh-day Sabbath, is true and correct. So they all want to come together and worship on Sabbath, have the feast, and all this stuff. So... it's amazing stuff, because I know I was sharing material. My husband been sharing material with Gayatri and the missionaries. A lot of times he's sharing on Bible prophecy information. And so he's saying now the people want to have worship on Sabbath, not Sunday, the first day of the week, which is the first day of the week. It's not really an authorized day by Yeshua. If you go and read the Bible in Genesis 2 and Hebrews 4th chapter and other parts of the Bible and Acts, you know, the apostles and all of them kept Sabbath, you know. Yeshua never changed it. So I thought this was really exciting stuff. So he telling me this guy, he's giving them all, you see the sheets, he brought them in. So they're getting ready to put them on this building. So I'm going to go ahead and show you the other part of the building. Really wonderful church he's putting up. So he bought the steel sheets in. As the people been donating and contributing and helping to put the church up because they want to have somewhere to fellowship. And he's doing it on his property, because somebody gave him some acreage years and years ago, and now he's doing it on his property. So I just love this testimony. A lot of people are going to be understanding that the Sabbath is a sign definitely for God's people. And I know in the end times, a lot of people, it's not going to be but two groups of people. Like I say, two groups of people. It's going to be those people who love Yeshua, Messiah, Ahaya, going to worship him in spirit and in truth. And others who don't. It ain't going to be too, you know, Yeshua is very simple. You know, he's not going to have like thousands and thousands of denominations and all these things going to be flooring all the time. It's going to be a stop. And it's going to just be two groups of people, the ones that worship God and the ones that do not worship God. And so you need to know whose side you're going to be on, because I don't want to have nothing to do with Satan, nothing to do with his allies, or nothing to do with his evil angels, nothing to do with his demonic angels, nothing to do with his fallen angels, nothing to do with his Nephilim spirits, nothing to do with his Nephilim giants. I don't want to have nothing to do with them, okay? So we need to know who we're going to serve. I just thought I would show you that testimony. Let me go on over here quickly and get into the mission report. And then get into the Bible. I don't know if my husband's going to join me today. I'm giving him a break today. But I'm going to go ahead and do it and get into the Bible. We're going to be getting into Nahum 3rd chapter. So let me go ahead and do this here right now. Go ahead and mute out again. All right.
You say your love goes on forever, that your mercy never stops. So why would I assume you'll be somebody that you're not? Like sun in the morning, I know you're gonna be there every day. So what on earth could make me be afraid? Good God Almighty.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Nothing like Yeshua. Nothing like him. Nothing like him, guys. I'm going to get on over here in the Bible. Father, be with me as I get into Nahum today. Such an appropriate chapter for what's going on around us right now. We thank you so much for your love for us, your care for us. We ask that you be with the people watching. Be with all the missionaries as they continue to do hard work and trust in you and believing in you and walking with your truth, Father, in your truth. Oh, you know, you said that the holy people will always follow you. The sheep will hear your voice. Oh, Father, your sheep will hear your voice. I'm so happy for all the missionaries working in the vineyard all over in Africa, India, Bangladesh, all over in Pakistan, Philippines. Just thank you so much for all of them, Father. We thank you so much for loving them, taking care of them. So we're going to go on over here now, Father. Let your Holy Spirit come be with me. And I ask it in my name, Yeshua Messiah, Jesus Christ. We know times are short, Father. Times are short. Woe to Nineveh. You know, Nineveh reminds me of America, really. It reminds me of America. So we're going to go on here. I'm going to read from the King James Version here. And so it says, woe to Nineveh, woe to the bloody city. It is all full of lies and robbery. They pray, departeth not. The noise of a whip and the noise of the rattling of the wheels and of the prancing horses and of the jumping chariots. The horseman lifteth up both the bright sword and the glittering spear. And there is a multitude of slain and a great number of carcasses. And there is none in of their carcasses. They stumble upon their carcasses. They stumble upon their corpse. Because of the multitude of the whoredoms of the well-favored harlot, the mistress of witchcrafts that selleth nations through her whoredoms and families through her witchcrafts. Behold, I am against thee, saith the Lord of hosts, and I will deliver thy skirts upon thy face, and I will show the nations thy nakedness and the kingdoms thy shame. And I will cast abominable filth upon thee and make thee vile and will set thee as a gazing stock. And it shall come to pass that all they that look upon thee shall flee from thee and say, Nineveh is laid waste. Who will bemoan her? Whence shall I seek comforters for thee? Wow. Art thou better than populous? No, that was situate among the rivers that had the waters round about it, whose rampant was the sea, and her wall was from the sea, answering a question, Ethiopia in Egypt were they her strength, and it was infinite, Put and Lubin were thy helpers, yet was she carried away, she went into the captivity, her young children also were dashed in pieces at the top of all the streets, and they cast lots for her honorable men, and all her great men was bound in chains. Thou also shall be drunken. Thou shall be hid. Thou shall also seek strength because of the enemy. All thy strongholds shall be like fig trees with the first striped figs. If they be shaken, they shall even fall into the mouth of the eater. Behold, thy people in the midst of thee are women. The gates of thy land shall be set wide open unto thine enemies. The fire shall devour thy bars. Draw thee waters for the siege. Fortify thy strongholds. Go into clay and tread the mortar. Make strong the bricklin. There shall the fire devour thee. The sword shall cut thee off. It shall eat thee up like the cankerworm. Make thyself many as the cankerworm. Make thyself many as the locusts. Thou hast multiplied thy merchants above the stars of heaven. The cankerworm spoileth and flieth away. Thy crowneth are as the locusts, and thy captains as the great grasshoppers, which camp in the hedges in the cold day. But when the sun arises, they flee away, and their place is not known where they are. Thy shepherds slumber, O king of Assyria. Thy nobles shall dwell in the dust. Thy people is scattered upon the mountains, and no man gathereth them. There is no healing of thy bruise. Thy wound is grievous. All that hear the bruit of thee shall clap their hands over thee. For upon whom hast thou wickedness passed continuously? You know, we just got wickedness everywhere, and it's continuing on. That's why he said, woe to the bloody city. It's full of lies, robbery. You know, it's like today, so much gun shooting, so much robbery, so much people just lying and stealing, so much adultery, so much fornicating, so much, all these things are happening every day in our life, every day. Women with women, men with men, children, killing their mothers and their fathers, grandparents killing their grandchildren. It's just so much killings and so much things happening. And Yeshua is saying, see, witchcraft. Everybody's into witchcraft, sorcery, astrology, all these things people are into. So it's time for us to come out, guys. Come out of Babylon, knowing that Yeshua is going to be the one. He's going to be the great King of Kings, Lord of Lords. We don't care about this AI. I don't care about all what they're doing. I don't care about this the globalists, what they're setting up, what they're trying to do. I don't care about the New World Order. I don't care about the One World Order. You know, we need to be caring about Yeshua's order, his order. He said he go to prepare a place. He go to prepare a place for us where we can be with him, people, forever and forever. Are you ready to be with him? Are you ready to give your life to him? It's time for us to be ready, to get ready, to be ready. And it's time for us to stop what? Stop messing around. Stop saying, I got time. Stop saying, oh, I'm just a teenager. Oh, I got to live my life. You know how we are. I got to get married first, Marner. I got to go here first. I got to travel. I got to do this. I got to do that. It's time to get on board. It's time to know Yeshua. It's time to know he's coming soon. All the red heifers are all in Israel. Everything's lining up. Everything's getting ready. Are you getting ready? You know, everything's getting ready. Are you getting ready? Satan know his time is short, but do you know your time is short? We don't know when our death, time is. We don't know when we're going to wake up the next morning. We may not wake up the next morning. We may not wake up the next night. We don't know. We don't know when we go out. We may not come back in. We need to get ready right now, guys. Ready right now. Okay. So I'm going to go on over here to Maranatha because time is really running here really fast already before me. But I know time is short, and I know that we need to do what we can while we can. I'm going to go on over here now to Maranatha. We're going to go here to September 5th, and read, let him read to us. I'm not right on the right. Hold on, guys. I'm going too fast and not knowing what I'm doing here. September 5th, we're going to go here to, I'm not still at September. Okay. Another Pentecost coming. So let me go ahead and get to that right now. Let me mute out. Okay.
September 5. Another Pentecost coming. I will make them and the places round about my hill a blessing, and I will cause the shower to come down in his season. There shall be showers of blessing. Ezekiel 34:26. Under the figure of the early and the latter rain that falls in eastern lands at seed time and harvest, the Hebrew prophets foretold the bestowal of spiritual grace in extraordinary measure upon God's church. The outpouring of the Spirit in the days of the apostles was the beginning of the early or former rain, and glorious was the result. But near the close of earth's harvest, a special bestowal of spiritual grace is promised to prepare the church for the coming of the Son of Man. This outpouring of the Spirit is likened to the falling of the latter rain. The great work of the gospel is not to close with less manifestation of the power of God than marked its opening. The prophecies which were fulfilled in the outpouring of the former rain at the opening of the gospel are again to be fulfilled in the latter rain at its close. Servants of God, with their faces lighted up and shining with holy consecration, will hasten from place to place to proclaim the message from heaven. By thousands of voices all over the earth, the warning will be given. Miracles will be wrought, the sick will be healed, and signs and wonders will follow the believers. Satan also works with lying wonders, even bringing down fire from heaven in the sight of men. Revelation 13:13. Thus the inhabitants of the earth will be brought to take their stand. The message will be carried not so much by argument as by the deep conviction of the Spirit of God. The arguments have been presented. The seed has been sown, and now it will spring up and bear fruit. Now the rays of light penetrate everywhere. The truth is seen in its clearness, and the honest children of God sever the bands which have held them. Family connections, church relations are powerless to stay them now. Truth is more precious than all besides. Notwithstanding the agencies combined against the truth, a large number take their stand upon the Lord's side.
That's exactly is going to happen. That's exactly going to happen. You know, even about the Sunday and the Sunday and Sabbath issue, I think she also talked about that. That one day, like I told you guys, going to be two groups of people. The ones that follow Yeshua and the ones that follow the world and, you know, their forces. And I'm telling you, it's coming. It's coming. People are going to take the side of the right side. The right side. If you follow me, Yeshua, no matter what denomination, no matter what church you've been going to, it doesn't matter. You're going to be knowing that the truth is nothing but the truth. And we're going to stand together. That day is coming, guys. That day is coming. I'm going to go ahead and close out now because time is going really quickly before me. So let me get on over here and close out. I really hope that you guys are understanding the things that's going on. You know, like I said, this here prophecy is about to come to pass right before our eyes at the toes of this statute that Daniel talked about in the dream is already about to come. You know, all these things are happening right now. So it's time for us to get ready, get ready, get ready, get ready. Don't forget the homeless people in your area, guys, wherever they may be, okay? They're going to be scattered. A lot of them are being taken off the streets and all kind of things are going on. So let me go ahead and get here and end the video. I thought I didn't put my clothes in there. But I really appreciate each and every one of you guys for being here today. So many things are happening everywhere. So if you want to hear my testimonies and my miracles that God put in my life, that he brought in my life, please write me for the hard copy. But either you could buy the ebook for $2.99 titled He Did What from Amazon, Apple, Google, Kobo.com, Lulu.com, Barnes & Noble. The link is on the screen. And also Son of Man Bible, download Gene's free e-Bible from Lulu.com, Kobo.com, Smashwords.com, Scribd.com, FMCMI.org. Read the Son of Man Bible PDF for free. Download the Son of Man Bible computer Bible modules for free. Download free at BibleSupport.com and WordModules.com. King James Version, you can go there at the same locations. One modular is SOTV, JKV. One has the Apocrypha, SOTV, KJVA. Also, I really appreciate each and every one of you guys for all your letters and cards and emails. The prayer reports that's coming in. I know that my friend, we had prayer reports going out yesterday. So a lot of people are doing recovering. Haven't heard from one person, Avis in Florida. Waiting to hear from her update. Please continually praying for her. She definitely don't want to be homeless. She's really worrying about that. I told her God will provide. He will provide. You know, we need to learn to stand on the promises of Yeshua. Just have to stand on them. You keep pulling on his leg. Daddy, you know, you said this and you said that, and I need your help. And you said you'll never leave me or forsake me. You said you will not forsake me in old age, you know, in Psalm 71. You know, you need to just put the promises before Yeshua and trust in him and believe in him and wait on him, guys. I'm telling you, I have had to wait. I have had to just struggle and talk to him and say, Father, it's like, you know, in the Bible. Jacob didn't turn him loose until he was blessed. So we need to learn to do that, okay? Learn to do that. So I thank you for all your offerings to help the homeless, the orphans, the widows, those in need of mission fields. May Yahuwah richly bless each and every one of you. FM CMI Alternative Channels or Rumble, BitChute, Facebook, fmcmi.org. Also donate by Cash App. Cash tag is there. Other donation options, fmcmi.org, mana.camo@gmail.com, at PayPal. Mail in your donations at Fill My Cup Ministries, Post Office Box 414, Canyon City, Colorado, 81215. Shipping address, Fill My Cup Ministries, 1501 Main Street, number 414, Canyon City, Colorado, 81212. Click subscribe, the like bell, subscribe to the YouTube channel, click the like button, click the notification bell. Our digital business cards are hashtags in front of you, and I'm going to go ahead and close out here now. Guys, I'm telling you, it's just really one of these times that we need to have faith more than ever. Faith more than ever. Trusting more than ever. Believing more than ever. Stop trying to figure it out. Stop trying to tell God what to do. Let him tell you what to do. Listen to his voice. Learn his voice. Read the Bible. Read the word every day, every night. Stay in the word. Stay in the word, guys. What can I say? It's the only way our word, our sword, the sword of the word is the only thing that's going to help us get through these hard times. We're going to have to stand. We're going to have to stand. We have to stand. He said to pray and not faint. Pray without ceasing. It's time for us to know how important it is to pray and trust and stop trying to see everything and know everything and just trust God. He work in mysterious ways. I don't know how to tell you. He just know what he's doing. He know what he's doing. It may seem like he don't know what he's doing, but he knows what he's doing. So we need to have faith, okay? Faith in Messiah, faith in Yeshua, reading the word every day and trusting in him in these evil times, guys. So Father, be with the people watching. I thank you so much for being here today. Thank you for your love for us, Father. I bind Satan and all his evil angels below, beyond, beneath, mentioned and unmentioned, known and unknown. I bind all evil spirits on assignment against us. I bind up the spirit of backlash. I bind up the spirit of every hex and vex and voodoo and black magic and witchcraft and sorcery. We bind up all the Nephilim spirits, crossbreed spirits, halfbreed spirits, strongman spirits. We bind them all up. We put them into the abyss, into the day of judgment. Father, we know no weapon formed against us will prosper. We ask that greater he that is in us, greater he that is in us than he that is in the world. We ask that you please help us, Father, to be more than conquerors for you in these end times, helping us to be strong in these end times. I put angels all around people, households tonight, every night, every day, angels to be with us, Father, to be with us, as you said in Psalm 91 and Psalm 121, and just to come and be with us every day, every hour, helping us to get through the storm of this life, the storms of our life, the storms of our people and our children. A lot of things we going on in our homes and marriages, and all over the world, people are dying, and homeless people, and everywhere, homeless people, drugs and alcohol is taking over people's lives, Father. Oh, help us to know we must run to you, come to you, trust you, believe in you. Oh, Father, don't let nothing stop us from our crown, nothing to stop us from heaven, nothing to stop us, Father. Oh, help us, help us, help us. We need your help today, Father. We need your help today. Be with all the people watching, supplying all the people needs, whether it's physical, mentally, spiritually. And we just thank you so much for being here with us today, Father. Your Holy Spirit to guide us into all truth. And we thank you for loving us in every way. And we ask that the people will follow you, because you said in your word that for we can do all things. We can do all things through Christ Yeshua Messiah, who's strengthening us. So thank you so much, Father, for being with us today. We ask these blessings in the mighty name of Yeshua. So people, I'm going to go now. You guys, I'll be back when I can. So please share the videos and go and listen to the other videos I mentioned on here, please. I will put all the other links in the description box. A lot of other links, a lot of other news will be in the description box as well. So you guys have a wonderful, wonderful Monday night. I love you guys so much. And I'm going to say shalom, shalom. I love you guys so much. Shalom, shalom. I love you guys so much.